ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरि ओम तत्सत् दिस इज कॉल्ड शांति मंत्र पीस चैंट टेकन फ्रॉम द उपनिषद्स एट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ स्टडी जनरली दिस एंड अ फ्यू अदर वर्सेस आर संग इट मीन्स ओम सहना भवतु लेट द डिवाइन प्रोटेक्ट बोथ ऑफ अस स्टूडेंट एंड टीचर सहनौ भुनक्तु लेट अस बी नरिश्ड बाय द डिवाइन सह वीर्यम करवावहै लेट अस अचीव ट्रेमेंडस स्ट्रेंथ एंड एनर्जी थ्रू दिस स्टडी एंड तेजस्विनौ अधीतमस्तु लेट अस बिकम एनलाइटेंड बाय दिस स्टडी मा विद्विषावहै Let us not hate each other, but only love each other. Om peace, peace, peace. With this Shanti Mantra, we commence today the study of the entire Bhagavad Gita of 700 verses divided into 18 chapters. Before we study the Gita, we study what they call the Gita Dhyana Shlokas, the meditation verses on the Gita. 9 verses, very fascinating and inspiring. Nobody knows who wrote these 9 verses. Some scholars say it is by the great Sridhara Swami of the 16th or 17th century, who wrote a commentary on the Gita and a beautiful commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we study this Gita Dhyana Shlokas. It begins with addressing the Gita as the mother, Amba. Amba is mother. Mahatma Gandhi said once that I lost my mother when I was young, but throughout my life I never felt the absence of a mother because I had the Gita as my mother. I refer to it every time. So you can see in the shloka beginning itself, Om Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Grathitam पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्ब त्वाम् अनुसन्धतामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं अम्ब ओ मदर भगवद्गीते ओ भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं विच डिस्ट्रॉयस रिलेटिविटी फाइनिट्यूड And their weaknesses within us, our creatureliness, it destroys. Tvam anusandhatami. You I meditate upon continuously. That is the last line. And the rest are a description of the Gita. Parthaya patibodhitam. It was to enlighten Partha, Arjuna, that this was taught by Bhagavata. By Bhagavan, Narayana Swayam, Sakshat Narayana, that infinite divine personality who came as Krishna as an incarnation. So Sakshat Narayana, Vyasena Grathitam, that was made into a 700 verses by Vyasa, the author of the Mahabharata, and introduced into his mighty epic. That Mahabharata, Purana Munina, Vyasa is known as Purana Muni, not only ancient sage, but also the sage who composed many Puranas, many beautiful religious works. Madhye Mahabharatam, introduced in the midst of Mahabharata. Advaita Amritavarshinim, this mother is what rains Advaita Amrita, the nectar of Advaita, non-duality. We are all one. That great philosophy is what you get out of the Gita. So it's called Varshinim, a raining of the Advaita inspiration. Bhagavatim, the blessed divine person. Ashtadashadhyayinim, having 18 verses. That mother, Amba, Anasandhatami, we meditate upon. That is the opening verse. Now comes Namostute Vyasa Vishara Buddhi, a tribute to Vyasa. You are Vishara Buddhi, extraordinary intellect. Namostute, salutations to thee, O Vyasa. Pullaravindayata Patranetra, your eyes are elongated like the petals of a lotus. Pullaravinda, that is how poets describe great person's eyes compared to the petals of a lotus slightly elongated. Yena tvaya bharata taila purna prajvalito jnanamaya pradipaha, by which you lit up a lamp of jnana, lamp of pure knowledge, spiritual knowledge. By how did you light it up? Through the oil of the Mahabharata, Bharata Taila. In that oil of Mahabharata is this wonderful lamp, jnana. Yena tvaya bharata taila purna prajvalito jnanamaya pradipaha. Pradipa means the light. And jnanamaya consisting of knowledge, full of knowledge, high knowledge. That is the service Vyasa has done to all humanity. Vyasa is highly praised in India. He is considered to be an extraordinary intellect. He divided the Vedas into four, editing it, then any number of Puranas, and then the Bhagavad Gita along with the Mahabharata itself, the greatest epic, an epic which is 9 times the 2 epics of Greece together. That is the nature of the Mahabharata epic. India has 2 great epics, Mahabharata, Ramayana. Next is a tribute to Sri Krishna. Prapanna Parijataya Totravetreka Parnaye Jnanamudraya Krishnaya Gita Amrita Duhe Namaha. Salutations to Krishna. What kind of Krishna? Krishna with the Jnana Mudra. This kind of mudra is called Jnana Mudra, the bodily kind of posture which has some spiritual, psychological meaning. So this is called Jnana Mudra. Krishna with the Jnana Mudra, who is Gita Amrita Duhe, the milk of the nectar of the Gita. That's what Krishna did. Prapanna Parijataya, who is also the wish-fulfilling tree to those who resort to him. We have got the concept of the wish-fulfilling tree, Parijata. Totrave Treka Panaye. In one hand, he has that stick to drive the cows. He was a cowherd. And so, Totrave Treka Panaye. Jnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gita Amrita Duhe Namaha. This is a beautiful idea. Jnana Mudra. What it means is difficult to say, but one thing seems to be clear, that the capacity to oppose thumb to forefinger is a human capacity. No animals, not even the chimpanzee, can do it. Chimpanzee can do only like this and never like this. And this is the beginning of man's technical ability, the human being's ability to manipulate nature and develop science, culture, civilization, and higher life. And so, this is considered to be the symbol of all jnana. And we don't make a distinction between physical knowledge and spiritual knowledge. Knowledge is one. It's a continuous pursuit. Therefore, Jnana Mudraya, Krishnaya. Many of the images in temples of great gods or the Divine Mother, you will find the same Jnana Mudra. And this is highly commended in all our spiritual literature. Then, Sarva Upanishado Gavo, Dogdha Gopala Nandanaha, Partho Vatsa Tuthir Bhokta, Dugdham Gita Amritam Mahat. Now comes a very beautiful analogy. All the Upanishads considered as a cow, Krishna as the milkman, Arjuna as the calf, and the milk drawn is the nectar of the Gita, and it is meant for the good people of the world to nourish them spiritually. Sarva Upanishado Gavo. Gavo is the word for cow. Dogdha, milkman. Duhu, to milk. Dogdha. Gopala Nandanaha, that cowherd boy. Gopala Nandana. Partho Vatsa. Arjuna is the calf. The calf drinks the milk a little. Then as it starts flowing, calf is tied away and milk is taken. Tuthir Bhokta, the good people of the world, they are the drinker of this milk. And what is that milk? Dugdham Gita Amritam Mahat, the great nectar of the Gita, is the milk so drawn by Krishna from the Upanishads. Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. The last verse, last line says, Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. We salute, I salute Krishna, the teacher of the world, Jagadguru. Not teacher of a sect, not teacher of a small number of people, but the whole world, humanity. Krishna kept humanity in view. So it's called Jagadgurum. Devaki Paramanandam, who is the blissful son of Devaki. He gave great joy to his mother, Devaki. Devaki, the joy of Devaki is Krishna. Similarly, Vasudeva Sutam, the son of father, Vasudeva. Tamsa Chanura Mardhanam, Vasudeva Sutam Devam, who has destroyed two evil forces, Kamsa and Chanura, during his young days. You will read it in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the 10th book, the story of Krishna, and during his early life, what all things he did. Here comes this Kamsa Chanura Mardhana story. Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. Now comes a very, very long shloka or verse. Bhishma Drona Tata Jayadrusajala Gandhara Nirvapala Shalyagrahavati Kripena Vahani Karnena Velakula Ashutthama Vigarna Karna Akara Duryodhana Avatini Sotirna Akalu Pandavai Ranadi Kaivartaka Keshavaka. The shloka says that great battle of Kurukshetra compared to a river, Ranadi, the battle river, the Pandavas could cross that river safely. It was full of dangerous things because Krishna was the helmsman. He was guiding the whole thing. Kaivartaka Keshavaha. Krishna was the Kaivartaka, the boatman. And what are the dangerous things? Bhishma Drona Tata, the two banks of the river. Bhishma Drona, mighty warriors of the Kaurava army. Jayadrata Jala, Jayadrata is the water in the river. Gandhara Nilotpala, Gandhara, the king of Gandhara, the Shaguni, he is the lotus, blue lotus, blue lily in that river. Shalya Grahavati, Shalya is a shark, another great character in the Mahabharata. Grahavati, Kripena Vahani, the current is Kripa, and Karna is the breakers, and Ashwatthama and Vikarna are terrible makaras, certain what you call wild and ferocious type of fish are makaras. Duryodhana avartini. Duryodhana is the whirlpool in that river. Sotirna, that river of battle was crossed over by the Pandavas safely with Krishna as the helmsman. Similarly, Parashari Vacha Sarvaja Mamalam Gitartha Ganthotkatam Nanakhyanaka Kesaram Harikatha Sambodhana Bodhitam Loke Sajjana Shradbadai Paharaha Pepiyamanam Muda Bhoyad Bharata Pankajam Kalimala Pradhamsina Shreyase. This is a tribute to the Mahabharata. May the tainless lotus of the Mahabharata, growing on the waters of the words of Parashara's son, that is Vyasa, having the Gita as a strong, sweet fragrance, with many a narrative as its stamens, fully opened by the discourses on Hari, the indwelling Lord in all, Hari, that is Vishnu or Krishna, and drunk joyously day after day by the Brahmara of the good and the pure in the world. The bees, Brahmara is the bees, they come and drink the honey that is there. Let this great Mahabharata be productive of the supreme good of him, to him who is eager to destroy the taint of Kali, evil age in which you live, to destroy it. This will be a great blessing. Whenever there is such evil, this kind of Gita will be a tremendous blessing to all. That is the greatness of the Mahabharata, which nurtured the Gita inside. Now comes a very oft-quoted verse by every saint in India. Mokam karoti vachalam pangum lankhayate girim yakripa tamaham bande paramananda madhavam. I salute the blessed Paramananda Madhavam, the infinitely blissful Krishna. His name is Madhava also. Whose grace, he says, tamaham vande, whose grace mokam karoti vachalam, makes a dumb become eloquent. That is the nature of divine grace. And pangum lankhayate girim, a man who is absolutely lame, he is able to cross mountains. Why and how? Yakripa, by whose grace? That Krishna I salute. Yakripa tamaham vande paramananda madhavam, all blissful Madhava. Then the last verse is also extremely popular. People recite it during prayers. Yam brahma varunendra rudra marutaha tunvanti divyaistavaihi vedais sangapata kramopanishadaihi gayantiyam samagaha dhyanavastita tadgatena manasa pashyantiyam yogino yasyantam nabidu surasara gunaha devaya tasmai namaha. Tasmai devaya namaha is the last portion. That, to that deva be our salutation, that divine person. The rest are further adjectives of the divine person. Salutations to that God whom the creator Brahma, then Varuna, Indra, Rudra and the Maruts praise with divine hymns, whom the singers of Sama Veda is known as a musical Veda. Singers of Sama by the Veda with their full complement of part, they sing. The singers of Sama sing, whom the singers of Sama sing by the Vedas with their full complement of parts, consecutive sections and Upanishads. They are all sections of the Vedas, whom the yogis see with their minds absorbed in him through perfection in meditation. That is a beautiful idea. The yogi, in depth of meditation, discover that infinite reality who is the self of all. You are that whose limit the hosts of devas and asuras do not know, who is infinite in every sense of the term. Here is a beautiful set of verses, 9 verses, known as Gita Dhyana Shlokas. meditation verses on the Gita. Here is a great book that came to us through the Mahabharata. It was part of the Mahabharata, included in that immense epic. Many people could not see its beauty or strength. But one great teacher appeared in the 8th century AD. He recognized the importance of this great book, the Bhagavad Gita. So he took it out of the Mahabharata as a separate book and wrote his most beautiful commentary on it, including a very beautiful preface, meaningful preface, which we shall study in the next lectures, and placed it before the people as a great book. From that time onwards, the Gita has become popular. All subsequent teachers also began to write commentaries on the Gita. This is the way that Shankara served the world, through bringing out the importance and significance of this great book of practical Vedanta. But in spite of all this, it was not fully known to people because it was in Sanskrit. It was there all the time in various monasteries or college places, etc. Swami Vivekananda pays a high tribute to Shankara for this great work. He says it is one of the greatest works that this great man did in his great life, to place the Gita before the people and write that famous commentary upon it. That is the story of the Gita. It was quite popular all over India, but only among certain sections of people. In the modern period, the Gita got a wider audience when it became translated into the English language by Sir Charles Wilkins of the East India Company in the 18th century. He was a Sanskrit scholar. So he translated the Gita. That is the first translation. And Warren Hastings was the first British Governor General in India. He wrote an introduction to that translation by Sir Charles Wilkins. In that introduction, this British Governor General has made a beautiful remark along with other things. He said, long after the British Empire has ceased to exist and the sources of its wealth and power are lost to remembrance, writings such as the Gita will continue to inspire generations of men and women. What a prophetic utterance it is. Today, British Empire is no more, but the empire of the Gita is expanding everywhere. The next great writer who made the Gita popular in the West through English was Sir Edwin Arnold, and the title of his book is marvelous, The Song Celestial. That is the exact meaning of the word Bhagavad Gita. Gita means song, good to sing. And whose song? Bhagavad song, divine song. And so The Song Celestial was a great book, mostly in poetic language. It has been expressed. Sir Edwin Arnold was in India. He understood Sanskrit. And so he published that book. And that book has undergone a few hundred, nearly 100 editions, you can say. The Song Celestial. He also wrote on Buddha, the famous book, The Light of Asia, which also inspired many scholars in the Western world. And that is how in the modern period, the Gita began to be translated. And today, in many, many languages, including Russian, Indonesian, etc., you get the Gita. It's a universal book. It was meant to be universal because it was taught by universal mind, that is Sri Krishna. Two great characters come here, Krishna, Arjuna. And for the first time, you get a book which is centered in a battlefield. Conversation between Krishna and Arjuna in the midst of a battlefield full of tension all round. And there, a profound philosophy, not of war and violence, but how to develop this human being, how to bring out the profound possibilities that are within him or her, that the main subject of the Bhagavad Gita, and this was very much considered to be practical Vedanta. We have the Upanishads containing profound truths. They are truths, not opinions, not dogmas. Truths which were discovered by sages and which you also can discover. That's why they are called truths. Anybody can discover. Therefore, such profound truths are there in the Upanishads. First and the most important truth is that each one of us has a divine spark within us. We are essentially divine. That is the central truth of the Upanishad. Penetrating this human system from the skin inward, in the depth dimension, they discovered the spark of the divine, the light of God. Everyone is essentially divine. Based upon this central truth, if everyone is divine, how shall we live in this world? How shall we work in this world? How can I establish relations with other people? All these questions come. The Upanishads had no time to deal with these practical implications of their great truths. Then comes Sri Krishna, a little later age. He brings out these practical implications. That is what you call the Bhagavad Gita. Vivekananda called it the best commentary on the Upanishads. In every chapter towards the end, you will find a colophon describing the chapter. Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishad Su Te Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvade. This is a Brahma, what you call Vidya, knowledge of ultimate reality, and its practical implication, Yoga Shastra, science of yoga, the practical implication of that Brahma Vidya, coming through a conversation between Krishna and Arjuna. That is the nature of this great book, Bhagavad Gita, says chapter after chapter, practical Vedanta. Now, in the second chapter, Krishna expounds that practical Vedanta, which is universal in scope. Normally, religion is something otherworldly to many people, all men for ascetics living in the forest, and the worldly man is worldly, he may have some piety and nothing more. But how to make an average human being working in the world, dealing with various aspects of life, how can he or she become spiritual? That is why the originality of the Gita consists in appealing to those people, and they are the millions in the world, working people as we call it. They may be in any department of life, but they are all working people. The special beauty of the Gita is that its message is addressed to these millions and millions of working people of all countries, of all types of people. How in the midst of work they can develop their spiritual possibilities. Within this life, living in the body, this is repeated again and again. You will hear later on when you go through the verses, heavens and hells are all thrown up. They have no meaning. We create hell here. We create heaven here. How to create heaven in society? There is one method. Try to manifest that divine within. You have the capacity to do so. Our science today, neurology tells us, the human being has been endowed by nature. Why? By an organic system by which he or she can understand the world, understand himself or herself. This capacity comes to us through our wonderful brain. If we utilize it properly, we can make for a heaven in our society by manifesting the divine within, and all our actions suffused with that vision, with that wonderful inspiration. So you find for the first time a book coming in the name of religion, where the center of interest is work. Work is the center of interest of the Gita, and the working person is the center of interest. As if Krishna goes to a worker, working on the roads, working in the household, working in the office, gently whispering to them, here, I'll give you a message that with this, you will be able to work better, efficiently, and by that, you will also grow spiritually within you. This is a remarkable message that has come to humanity for the first time through the Gita. Generally, religious books are centered man at worship, man at meditation, man in samadhi, all the or doing some ritual or ceremony. That's what we see. But in this book, we are dealing with the human being at work. That during that work, and as a worker, he or she can work better, more efficiently, and also achieve his own or her own spiritual growth. This combination is what is called by a short name in the second chapter, yoga. This is yoga as expounded in the Gita. This is not like any other yoga. We have got many other types of yoga, but the yoga expounded in the Gita is that by which you work, and by your work, you enrich society. By your work, you also grow spiritually. That's why a beautiful definition is given later on. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Yoga is efficiency in action. A double efficiency, productive and spiritual. And so, we have in this book the philosophy of practical Vedanta. It was with us for centuries together, but we didn't utilize it properly. The way India utilized the Gita is something very unfortunate. We worshipped it, we honored it, we committed it to memory, but we never tried to live it, practice it. It is meant for practice. We did not do it. We just read in the Gita Dhyana Shlokas. Gita is the milk drawn by Krishna from the cow of the Upanishads. That milk is meant to be drunk. But we did everything with milk except drink it. We worshipped it, put it on the head, honored it, everything. But we didn't drink it. Therefore, that spiritual nourishment and that broad human attitudes we could not develop all the time. We had narrowness, caste, community exclusiveness, and many other evils appeared in society. Therefore, our reverence to the Gita till now lacked the most essential thing, how to live this teaching, create a society where all are free, all are equal. Human dignity is established there. All that will come in the course of the teaching here. And so, today we need to understand the Gita is meant to be lived, to be practiced, not merely a pious book to read for mental consolation. All over India, I have found this wrong understanding among our people regarding the Gita. And I came to know it a little more intensely when I visited this city, Hyderabad, in 1949. I was on a tour of Andhra Pradesh after finishing a long tour of the Assam and Eastern region. After several days of lectures in the university, etc., in this city, friends told me, why not pay a visit to General Chowdhury, the military governor of Hyderabad at that time, appointed just after the police action. That was 1949, October. So I said, yes, we shall go and meet him. So we went to meet General Chowdhury. He sat across the other table, and he did all the talking for the first half an hour. I was listening. I saw a copy of the Gita on his table. That gave me an opportunity to start the talking. Then Chowdhury, do you read the Gita? He said with a sense of tiredness, oh yes, I read it when I feel the need for a little peace of mind, a little consolation, a little relaxation. I said, that is not the purpose of that book. And I said it with a little firmness. He looked up. Do you mean to say this book has a message to me as a worker, as the governor of the state? Do you mean to say that? I thought it is only meant just to get a little peace of mind. He said, no, this is the book meant for you as a worker, as a responsible worker of society. For peace, you get plenty of other books. This is not for that kind of peace. He was puzzled. Again, he put this question, can I get guidance from this book? I said, let us take the fourth chapter. After expounding his philosophy in the second and third chapters and calling it yoga. Yoga is the word that is used for that philosophy. And in the fourth chapter, you find the great idea coming that this great yoga, Krishna says, I taught to great kings, emperors, those who have to deal with various problems of human society. Why? To give them strength, to bring about heart, happiness and welfare in people. So men and women of responsibility, they need to be given a philosophy by which they will discharge the responsibility, and while discharging it, not only make people happy, but they also become spiritually richer, richer, richer. This is the language used in the first two verses of the fourth chapter. When I told him, he was very much impressed. Shankaracharya comments there, Durbalan Ajitendriyan Prapya Yogo Nashta Parantapa. Arjuna, this yoga was very active in society. People with responsibility lived according to yoga. They did wonderful good to the people. But in course of time, due to weakness, physical and mental, yoga became diluted and lost in society. That's yoga now I am communicating to you, Arjuna. That is the language in the fourth chapter. When I said this, he was immensely happy. He said, I never thought like this. Then I asked him, have you read Vivekananda's book? He said, I have read small books, sayings of Vivekananda. He said, that won't do. I shall send you a book when I go to Delhi tomorrow. Lectures from Colombo to Almora, which has created the conscience of modern India. Read it. If you promised you will read, I will send you an autographed copy. I don't want to waste a book unless you read. I don't like to send. No, I shall read, he said. Then he took me to the car with all love and regard. We became close to each other. I went to Delhi and from there sent the book with a letter, and he acknowledged it saying, I have benefited by this. Later on, he was a commissioner in Canada. He took my permission to translate my lecture on the spirit of India, essence of Indian culture, into French for distribution in the French area of Canada. That is the story of General Chowdhury. Only an illustration. All over India, people high and low always thought, whenever you are tired and you are depressed, take the book and read like a pious book. That is not. Today, what is to be understood, therefore, by our people is, here is milk to be drunk, to be digested, to be assimilated, so that you become physically, mentally, spiritually strong, and that strength is to establish a heaven around you by interhuman relationship being based on our spiritual oneness. That is the great work that we can do in this modern period. I'm glad there is a lot of interest in the study of the Gita, and I hope that interest to be transformed in this way, creating a new, healthy human society, first in India, as well as in the rest of the world as well. Shankaracharya's preface to this great book, or introduction to this great book, is marvelous. I shall be expounding it later in the course of the next several weeks, every Sunday. So the next few weeks, for a year or two, we shall be living with the Gita every Sunday in this hall, Vivekananda Hall of the Ramakrishna Math, Hyderabad. So many of you have come, hundreds of you, young and old, coming from all sections of society. I'm very happy that you need this wonderful strength coming from practical Vedanta's message. You will get it through the book in the course of these Sundays. I'm very happy to be with all of you. This is the first day, the beginning, and we shall be together for weeks and weeks together. We shall take up the subject of Shankara's preface to the Gita next week when we meet here. Today, we end here. We will have a few minutes silence and quiet, and then we shall disperse. वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं. सैल्यूटेशंस टू कृष्णा, द टीचर ऑफ ह्यूमैनिटी, हु इज द सन ऑफ वसुदेव एंड द ब्लेस्ड लव बिलवेड ऑफ देवकी, डिस्ट्रॉयर ऑफ इवल फोर्सेस. टू हिम बी अवर सैल्यूटेशन.